Good evening, everyone. I'm Tim Norris, and I'll be presenting my final year project that I completed as part of my civil engineering degree at the University of Newcastle. So the name of my final year project, the title was the Experimental and Numerical Modelling of the Impact Trucks Have on Berms. This is part of a larger group of research by the Australian Coal Association Research Project by Klaus Toini and Energia Comini, and their paper is titled The Energy Absorption Capacity of Muck Piles and Their Status as Engineered Hard Barriers. So my final year project just made up a small part of that overall research. So really, in general terms, what we're looking at here is the interaction between trucks and berms. So to get a few definitions out of the way, you've obviously got your haul trucks there. The picture of this one is the Cat 797, ultra-class haul truck, capable of a payload of 400 tonnes. So a really large piece of machinery. There's then two different types of berms. So you've got your haul road berms, which is this picture here, and they run alongside the side of the haul roads. And they're not actually designed to stop a runaway truck at all. They'd have to be too large to be able to stop that momentum. But they are there to give a visual indication to the drivers, and also if the driver's running off track, it does allow them to correct their path. The second type of berm is the dump point berm. So obviously, as you'd expect, that's placed at the edge of steep embankments where the trucks are there to dump their load. Some mine sites actually prefer the trucks to dump not right off the edge and then get a dozer to push it over, but they still do this at some mine sites. So that's a dump point berm. So more specifically, this project aims to, the overall research by ACARP aims to determine the energy absorption capacity and then provide guidelines that mine operators will be able to use to design the most efficient berms for their mine sites. My specific final year project, I was there to correlate full-scale testing, reduced-scale testing, and numerical modelling. This is done in three different stages, really. First, the full-scale testing, which is conducted prior to my final year project at a few mine sites in the Hunter Valley. So that was done at low speeds with high-speed cameras and the results obtained and analysed from that. The second stage was the reduced scale, and at a 1 to 50 scale using die-cast model trucks. This was done in the laboratory at the University of Newcastle. And then the numerical modelling uses a discrete element method in the open source framework YAID. And so what we want to do with these three models, to be able to come up with these guidelines, it's very, firstly, costly and dangerous to run full-scale testing to get all the results you need. So it would be good to be able to design these guidelines with a computer program or a numerical model, and that's where the reduced scale testing comes in. So if you can correlate the results from the reduced scale testing to the full scale testing, then the numerical modelling to the reduced scale testing, you can then model it numerically, the full scale testing. So that's why it's a three-step process. My final year project, firstly I did a literature analysis, and I looked at what the accidents on mine sites, what type of accidents were occurring, and their frequency and where they were occurring at, and also what the current berm design guidelines are and what's in use today. I then went on to the reduced scale testing. So this involved sieving the material down to the 1 to 50 scale, running the reduced scale testing, and then analysing the results. Then this was followed by the numerical modelling. So that's the discrete element method, and analysed the results from that. So what I found from the literature analysis and what the current berm design guidelines are. So originally, the guidelines said that the height of the berm should be half the diameter of the wheel of the largest truck using the road. Obviously, with the haul trucks increasing in size, this guideline has been increased to 2/3 the diameter of the wheel, and that's what the current guideline really is. So of note was that all of the recommendations in the literature, they only focus on the haul road berms, so the ones that run alongside the road. There wasn't much emphasis on the dump point berms, even though there is accidents occurring at these sites. Also, there wasn't any information on what the berm should be constructed of, what type of material, how it should be constructed, should it be compacted and rolled, or can it just be dumped and shaped there, as most mine sites are doing at the moment. And if you do construct a berm, what's this berm capable of restraining? What's the energy absorption capacity of it? So none of these topics were really, I couldn't find any information in my literature review. So this is the reduced scale model that I used at the university. So the ramp here on the left, that's what the trucks run down. You can obviously vary their velocity based on how high up the ramp they are. The berm is constructed down here on that plate using the spoil and the sieve down, 1 to 50 scale soil. There's a high-speed camera set up here, and that records the data into the computer. The light's there to give better imagery, and the laser beams there and there, they just record the velocity of the impact. So with the two, we had two 1 to 50 scale die-cast models. One's the modelled off the CAT 793 and one's the CAT 797. And there was three different berm shapes. So there was a large trapezoidal berm and then two different sized triangular berms. And we collided the trucks in both forward and reverse motion. And in total, there was 86 reduced scale tests done. The spoil material that we used was sieved down from spoil material from the Drayton mine in the Hunter Valley. And that was collected when they did full-scale testing at the Drayton mine as well. So I've got a video here from the high-speed camera. It's in black and white. It's just a save on the memory that was required.
Now, the same problem, that's why I'm using my laptop.
Ah, okay.
It's not installed, so you won't play.
Right. Well, if that video played, you would just see the truck running into the berm here.
Do you have the video file on your computer?
Nah, it's not on, it's
just
on the USB.
The
yeah, just in the presentation. So sorry about it, guys. Videos are always the most exciting thing. So, from the high-speed camera, we use a program called Tracker. So in Tracker, you can identify a point of interest. In this case, it was the axle of the leading tyre, whether that be in forward or reverse motion. Tracker then can collect the wheel climb and wheel displacement based on the images that were collected from the high-speed camera. So what was really important was how we were going to define if the berm passed or if the berm failed. And what we came up with was that if the wheel climb, so that's how high from this diagram, how high the wheel comes up, if the wheel climb was equal to the height of the berm, that was classified as a failure. Or if the wheel displacement, being how far it displaces through the berm, was equal to half the width of the berm, that would also be a failure. And what we came up with was for the three different berms, the two different trucks in the two different directions, there was a failure velocity for each of those models. They're identified in the table here, but I won't go into too much detail. But by graphing the impact velocity and either the wheel climb or the wheel displacement, we were able to come up with the failure velocity. Unsurprisingly, the larger triangular berm had a higher failure velocity than a smaller triangular berm. And the trapezoidal berm actually had a higher failure velocity than either of them. Of note was that the triangular berms, the failure criterion was always through wheel displacement, so the truck just travelled straight through the berm rather than climbing up it. And with the trapezoidal berm, because it was wider, the wheel climb was the dominant failure criterion. Alright, so the third stage of my final year project was the numerical modelling. So I used the discrete element method and ran it in the open source framework called YAID. The discrete element method is really well suited to models that have many discrete particles in it, like a soil, and in this case a berm. So what the discrete element method is, you can pretty much break it down into three separate sections. So you set up your model, each of those soil particles is modelled as a discrete rigid element, and then you introduce an initial force for that. In this case, it's the tyre hitting the berm. So the second phase, it calculates based off some of the characteristics you give to the soil, such as the cohesion, it's being acted on by gravity, and the weight of each of those particles. It calculates the forces between the particles when they interact with each other. And then the third phase of the discrete element method just uses the laws of motion to calculate the acceleration and the direction of where each of those particles is going. So this is repeated over thousands of different time steps for the simulation. And this is what the discrete element method is. So I've got another video here that's probably not going to work. Yep. So sorry about that one. But the tyre here, it's modelled as discrete elements. I don't know if you can see that too well there, but it's actually as a clump, so they won't separate from each other. Whereas the particles in the berm, these are all separate individual discrete elements. So when the tyre hits it, these particles can just go wherever they want. It's not like a finite element model where they're all linked together. So that's the benefit of modelling discrete elements, soil particles in the discrete element method. So the discrete element method is really computational heavy or intensive. So we have to make a few simplifications. The one being is the particle size distribution. So because the Drayton mine swirl was very fine material, we actually had to use just a small section of the particle size distribution, which is indicated by this blue line, to model the soil particles in the berm. The red line is the actual particle size distribution. Based off the YAID output, where you graph your displacement and your velocities in it outputs these graphs, you can then get your failure velocities for each of those different berms. So for the discrete element method, we used the triangular berms, the trapezoidal berm, just due to the sheer number of particles in that berm, you can't model it, there's too many particles, so the triangular berms we used. And for the small triangular berm that we used in the reduced model, in the CAT 797 truck, from the graph, from the table, the failure velocity was 14.7 kilometres an hour. In the numerical model, it estimated the failure velocity to be 12 to 14 kilometres an hour. So you can see that the numerical model is getting very close results to the reduced scale testing. So in this summing up, we found that it is going to be possible to correlate the full scale testing, the reduced scale testing, and the numerical modelling. I found that in my final year project, and there is some more work to be done to just fine tune each of those different correlations. But it's definitely something for further research, and we'll be able to come up with those design guidelines that mine sites will be able to use and to construct berms that are actually designed for a specific purpose, depending on what trucks are using the road, the size of them, and the road conditions. So there is still further work to be done on this, but we've definitely proved that it's possible to correlate the numerical model to the full-scale testing through that reduced-scale testing. So I'll answer any questions that you'll have. So the paper that's been released and what this has gone into is this one down the bottom, if anyone's interested, and that's by the Australian Coal Association Research Project. And Dr. Klaus Toini is in the audience too. He may be able to help me out for any questions. But yeah, Dr. Klaus Toini and Anna Giacomini, you can look those guys up if you're interested in reading anything more about this research.